basically is not working. It's not that we don't love you, it's just not functioning. So welcome to Sweatfest 2017. You can do this in motion right here, that's okay. Jumping will not make you cool, but we highly encourage it during worship. So y'all can stand with us as we worship this morning, and we're just going to persevere through the heat, and we're just going to worship our Father this morning.
Yeah. But then I said, well, I have this happen. And it was, see, it's blowing some of that in. But it was raining, and you had those doors open, it was bringing that AC water from the hall to this.
Please bear with us. We're trying to get as much air moving in here as we can, but it's going to be warm for today. Hopefully, Pastor Arthur will keep it short so we don't. Okay. Thank you, everybody, for bearing with us.
Again, we're just going to call this Sweatfest 2017, and we're just going to worship through this, and nothing's going to hold us down. So, y'all are sweating, we're sweating.
Thank you.
raise that high. Make that a proclamation to the world.
almost like a spiritual law of thermodynamics. It's just, that's just what's going to happen, right? But then sometimes you'd expect there to be also conflict from within that can cause problems. And then beginning of chapter 3, sometimes that conflict can come with bad teaching. Right? So he talks about that, and we went through that last week. But he makes the point, as we saw, that you don't want to use your past as some means of trying to find fulfillment, especially now that you're in Christ. And Paul says, you know, if anybody wanted to use a resume to make themselves look good or feel good about themselves, Paul says, I can do that. And went through the whole list of different things. And Paul says, all of that now is manure, right? I remember, how many years, was it 2 years ago when the tornado came through this area? It was 2 years ago. Two Christmases ago, right? It was on Christmas. Because my in-laws were in our house, and we were all in the bathroom together. That was an experience. And all of us huddled up because of all the tornado. And I remember going back, because my kids were at a homeschool co-op, and we would take George Bush going back and forth after the tornadoes. And I remember driving, and I would see their school football stadium, football field, that where they were piling a lot of the debris from houses. Like, you could see it off the turnpike. And I remember one day driving by, and there was a huge grinder that was grinding up all that debris from all kinds of homes that were, you know, 200, 300, maybe more than that, $1,000 homes. And it was all being ground up, what was left of them, being ground up in size. All the labor, all the work that goes into building a house, and then you move into a house and live in it, one tornado ruins it, and it all becomes sawdust. Right? Paul says, that's what all my previous stuff was. Once you give me Christ, all that stuff is ground up. It's no longer useful, right? But again, we can't say everything in one sermon. We have to put a period somewhere, right? So you won't be back, or at least put up when you come back. So he's still talking about that in verse 12. Right? He's still what I call on a roll. Right? He's still talking about this issue. But now all the way down to verse, actually all the way down to chapter 4, verse 1, but verse 7, chapter 4 for next week. His point that he's going to make is, everything that I'm doing and that I'm striving after and the way I'm living, I want you Philippians to do the same thing. And so he's talking about himself, but he also knows that the Christian life is not just about you becoming Christ-like. That's very important. We have an emphasis sometimes, your personal walk with the Lord, your personal relationship with Jesus, your personal holiness, your personal discipleship, and all that's good. Don't misunderstand. All that's important. But it's not all. Because discipleship is not about one person, one believer being like Jesus. It's about all of us. God does not have an only child. He doesn't have grandkids either, but that's another story. He doesn't have an only child. He's got chickens. Okay? All kinds of kids that all have to grow up, okay, and be like big brother, which is Jesus. Okay? Paul knows that. And so he's still talking about his personal life and how he wants the Philippians, and obviously we as well, to have the same perspective. All right? And this is the perspective. I want you to keep this image in your head as we go through these verses. What Paul's going to do is he's going to talk about two brackets. Okay? Now, I know football's coming up. I don't mean those kind of brackets. College basketball's over. I don't thank the Lord. I don't mean those kind of brackets. Okay? I'm like a parenthesis. Got one at the beginning and one at the end. So you use whatever image you want. Brackets, parentheses, whatever. Okay? For Paul, what he's going to talk about two brackets. One is going to be what we call conversion, where he found the Lord, where you come to Christ. Alright? And once that happens, everything before that bracket is sawdust. It's ground up now. You're no longer living under the shackles of all those things that happened before that. For instance, another letter he writes to the church of Corinthians, you probably know the verse by heart, those who now are in Christ, old things are what? Passed away. Which is kind of odd in English for us, passed away, we mean someone's died. But there it means it's blown away, it's gone. Okay? Old things are passed away. All things now are become new. Right? Just another way of saying it. So everything before that bracket, you're not that person now. Right? So that first bracket is conversion. But then the other bracket, the other side of the parenthesis, or parentheses, is the day of resurrection, the day the Lord comes back and our hope becomes sight. Whenever our hope and the things we believe become tangible, we can touch them, okay? We can taste them, we can experience them, right? So something that's already happened and something that we're waiting to happen. Those two brackets, all right? Every one of us live in between that. That's going to be Paul's point. All of us are in between that. Those of us who are the Lord, we've had a conversion, and our hope, the reality of our conversion is essentially a preview of another change that we're still waiting on. All the change didn't take place. We didn't experience all the change yet. There's still some more to experience. I hope there is. So we don't need some work. You know, the Lord's got to change all of us completely, right? The question, though, is what do you do in the middle? That's the million-dollar question. What do we do in the middle of those two brackets? Something has changed, but not everything's changed. So what are we supposed to do in between those two marks? That's what Paul's talking about. Because notice now, he gave his resume last week, first part of chapter 3, and he says all that now is off the table because I have Christ. All right, so that's bracket number one. And now he wants to talk about being in between. At the end of last week, we saw he's converted, all the things the pastor has put away, that's bracket one. And he's also wanting fellowship with Christ in his suffering, being conformed to his death, somehow wanting to obtain to the resurrection, bracket number two. But now again, verse 12, but now what am I doing in the meantime? Not that, Paul says, not that I've already reached the goal, hasn't been resurrected yet, I haven't been conformed to the image of Christ's death yet. I haven't been glorified yet. Or I'm already perfect, or some translations have obtained, right? But I make every effort to take hold of it, because I also have been taken hold of by Christ Jesus. Sometimes Protestants get uncomfortable with this kind of language. Paul says, there's something I have. I have the Lord has me. But because I have him, he has me, I always want more. I want more. Or I want to, maybe the way we were seeing it earlier, experience more. I want to be changed by more. It's very important. A lot of times we just want to talk about getting saved and Jesus coming back one day, and we don't want to talk about everything in between. Paul has a lot to say about what's supposed to be going on in between. Paul says, I'm reaching for the goal, striving to take hold of it, because also I have been taken hold of by Christ. Brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself to have taken hold of it. Paul's basically, okay, this is my goal. I haven't achieved it yet. I haven't laid hold of it yet. So, what one thing I do, forgetting what's behind, okay, other side of bracket one, forgetting what's behind, and reaching forward to what is ahead. Remember last week, you can't pursue Jesus with only one hand. You have to pursue it with both. That means you have to let go of whatever's in the past. If you're going to try to hold on to the past with one hand and grab on to the front one, try to chase Jesus with the other, Jesus has some pretty strong things to say about that attitude. Basically, his point is, you're not following me at all. If you put your hand to the plow and turn back, you're not worthy to be my disciple. And that's his basic way of saying, don't waste your time. Leave. Jesus was pretty emphatic about that sometimes in the Gospels. People would walk an aisle. Jesus would meet them and say, go back to the pew. We talk about what would Jesus do? That's not always a good question. You don't mean business. This is just a show for you. Go back to your seat. He would do that sometimes. If you're going to pursue me, pursue with both hands in front of you. Don't try to have one. Well, I've got to go bury my father. Let the dead bury the dead. What would Jesus say? That wouldn't always go well unless you're Jesus. Keep that in mind. And Paul here, I haven't taken hold of one thing I do, forgetting what's behind and reaching forward to what is ahead. What is it that's ahead? I pursue as my goal the prize promised by God's heavenly call in Christ Jesus. My whole life is a life pursuing what is ahead. If the ultimate goal is resurrection, culmination of my hope, and being like Christ. And anything that can remotely make me look like him a little bit now, that's what I'm at. That's what I'm at. Okay? But notice he's not done. Verse 19, excuse me, 15. Therefore, let all of y'all, or us, let all of us, notice here, who are mature, think this way. In other words, Paul's saying, if you're picking up what I'm laying down, then you'll do the same thing. If you're childish in your faith, you may not understand what I'm saying, but if you're grown up, if you're becoming a grown up, spiritually, if you're mature, you will think the same way. And notice this, and if you think differently about anything, God will reveal this also to you. In other words, if you're not mature enough to handle what I'm saying, then the Lord may have to lower the boom on you later in life so that you learn this lesson. Spiritual maturity is about learning how to ask the right questions. I can remember when I was a teenager, and maybe the same way now, I don't know, when I was a teenager in youth group, youth directors would talk about dating, and every single one of us had the same unified question we would ask about dating. How far can you go without getting zapped by lightning? That was always, I don't know if that's a question anymore, but that was, you know, is premarital intervegetation okay? You know what intervegetation is? These are your digits. So holding hands, we would always joke. You can have premarital intervegetation. You can hold hands. I think it was holding hands only was the rule of the church where I grew up. You know, you have all these different, you know, so how far can you go without getting zapped by lightning, you know, without God lowering the boom on you? And as I, you know, grew up and learned a little more about life and became a little more committed to the Lord, I realized it's not that those kind of questions are bad questions. They're just short-sighted questions. Because, you know, that kind of question makes perfect sense whenever I was 15 or 16 years old or, you know, wanted to go out. That question seemed perfectly legitimate. But then when I became a husband and a father, those questions seemed really juvenile, arbitrary, even deceptive, with ulterior motives. Because, as a husband and dad, I know how guys are. Most guys, there's always an exception. Like, guys, I like that. Okay. Whatever. I won't go down that road. But I learned that that question is not concerned about what's right or wrong. That question is concerned about what can I get away with. And there's no way you would go to Jesus and ask that question. Hey, Lord, what can I get away with tonight? That question's not going to work. A better question is, hey, when I go out with this person tonight, is their walk with the Lord going to be enhanced by being in my presence for a few hours? Oh, that's boring. Well, if you think the Lord's boring, then yeah, I guess it's boring. So asking certain questions reveals immaturity. Right? And Paul's saying here to these Philippians, if you're not picking up what I'm laying down, it's because you don't really understand the full significance of what it means to follow Jesus. You do a little bit, but you got some growing up. But for those who do understand what I'm saying, Paul says, in any case, verse 16, we should live up to whatever truth we have attained. I dare say that forever, having a few more months, it goes until y'all have your new under-shepherd, new pastor. I could probably go back and preach the same sermons I've been preaching to you again. Because a lot of you, know a lot about the Lord and the Bible. But the issue isn't just what we know, it's what do we do with what we know. Right? And Paul's saying here, look, you've got knowledge. Now the question is living to whatever truth you have. join in imitating me, brothers and sisters, and pay careful attention to those who live according to the example you have in us. Paul knew, this is very important, Paul knew, whenever you're pursuing Christ and you're striving after him, always recognize, it doesn't matter how many people you know, whether you're a hermit, an introvert, or a people person on steroids, it doesn't matter. Whoever you are, you leave fingerprints on other people. You do. Right? You may not think you do, but you do. And whatever decisions you make will affect other people. And so Paul is saying here, look, I'm not just pursuing Christ because my eyes are fixed on him. I also know that there might be people behind me that are trying to get... There's no Google Maps following Jesus. That would be awesome. Turn left at 500 feet. It would be great if that's the way the Christian walk was, that the Lord sent down a God app. Godel. Is that blasphemous? I don't know if that's blasphemous or not. That just tells you what you need to do in every life situation. Should I buy this house? Should I buy this car? Should I, that would be wonderful. It doesn't work that. But one thing you can have are good examples. Paul knew that. And whether you know it or not, there may be more people than you realize who are behind you looking at you to see which direction you're going. Because of it. Paul knows that. So he says, brothers and sisters, pay attention, careful attention, to those living according to the example you have in us. So Paul says, this is my goal. Then he says, I want it to be your goal. But then thirdly, the last part, Paul says, recognize it's not going to be everybody's goal. It's not going to be everybody's. He says in verse 18, I have told you, and I'm saying it again with tears. In other words, he's not just saying this as, just a mere politician who's just trying to state business. No, his heart's in this. There are many that live as enemies of the cross of Christ. Now, again, he doesn't specify. It may be the Judaizing false teachers you mentioned earlier in the chapter. Maybe people who were part of the church that defected. We don't know. But they're enemies, and their end is destruction. If you're going to be an enemy of the cross, there's one destination, destruction, judgment. And then notice this. What's another way you can tell these people don't follow the Lord? They're enemies of the cross. They're enemies of destruction. Their God is their stomach. What? Now, he doesn't mean they're in the South and they want fried food. That's not his point. Some translations have their God is their appetite. All right? And that is definitely true in our day. Many people, young, old alike, their lives are strictly driven by their desires. Maybe food, money, sex, all kinds of pleasure, and they live by their appetites. That's the way they live. I tell students, look, if a culture is pumping out the idea that we are merely advanced primates at the top of the food chain, don't be shocked when people act like one. If you're going to tell people that you're an advanced chimp, okay, fair enough. But when they act primal, don't correct them. If that's always, if we're just primates that have more smarts than other ones, and then we act in ways that seem nonsensical or violent, well, why would that be wrong? That's what primates do. And they pound their chest and then they beat up the weaker ones. That's what they do, right? That's what silverbacks do. I want to slam silverback. That's what you expect. And here, Paul's saying people live by their appetites. You cannot follow Christ and do everything you want to do. As a matter of fact, a prerequisite to following Christ is saying, I no longer have a right to do what I want to do. And the only way to get that kind of reality is to die. That's what Jesus says. If you're going to follow me, you got to pick up a cross. That's the only way, because nobody willfully picks up a cross. Who would willfully pick up a cross? You are forced to. But Jesus, if you're going to follow me, you have to freely pick up a cross. Because if you die, Now you're ready to live. Now you're ready to live in a way that you can on your own. So there is their God is their appetite or their stomach, and their glory is their shame. It's not just whatever their sins are, whatever it is they stand for, but wrong. It's not just that they propagate it and live by it. They are cocky about it. They put it in your face. Very important. Sin is not a new thing. Sometimes like Christians, I'm shocked that sometimes Christians are shocked when cultures decay. That's what cultures do. They decay. They rot. That's just the nature of history. That's what they do on their own. And a part of the decaying process is reveling in the debauchery. We're just partying, having a cut loose, fancy free attitude about whatever it is that's shameful. Instead of hiding it, putting it on stage because they've been proud of it. Paul says that was going on in his day. And the Roman Empire was as corrupt as you could be. I would have to go into rated R lingo to tell you things that went on in the Roman Empire. And I'm not talking about military conquests. I'm talking about everyday life. It was horrendous. I'll try to keep one PG for me. The Corinthians, where Paul, or not Corinthians, the Ephesians, right? With a letter to Ephesus, that Paul wrote, Ephesus had a huge temple to a goddess named Diana. And this temple had priestesses, right? Priestesses that worked in the temple. And you could go stop by after work at this big temple and have visits with the priestesses. To worship Diana for the purposes of fertility. And then if you went home to your wife or wives afterwards, you did not cheat on your wife because it was a religious practice. You were involved in something. It was basically sexual sanctuary. Because it wasn't really considered a regular activity because it was religious by nature. Now, again, that's just a PG thing. There's all kinds of debauchery. And Paul goes to these areas and wins converts, and we're really all kinds of problems. Having to write letters to correct all this stuff, right? So Paul says, look, this shameful stuff's going on all the time. And then why is that? Because they are focused, in verse 19, on earthly things. Again, not just earthly things in the sense of the planet, but the way people do things on earth without any concern for how heaven does things. That's the key. How people on this earth do things without any concern for what God says about how things should be done. Their minds are on earthly things. But verse 20, again, Paul mentions this several times, and here it comes again, but our citizenship is in heaven. One day, Revelation 21 and 22, heaven and earth will be the same location. They'll merge. Heaven and earth will be a new heaven and a new earth. You won't have to go to heaven to be with the Lord. The Lord in heaven will come here. But that ain't happened yet. That hasn't happened yet. So our citizenship is in heaven. And we eagerly wait for the Savior from there, the Lord Jesus Christ, out of the bracket. We're waiting. He will transform the body of our humble condition into the likeness of His glorious body by the power that enables Him to subject everything to Himself. So here's the quick sola, and then we can stop fanning and move on to the announcements and invitation and singing. Recognize those two brackets, your conversion and the resurrection of our bodies and new creation. Recognize those two things only happen because God exhibits power in our lives. When Christ was raised from the dead, Paul says in another letter he wrote to the Romans, Romans chapter 8, that power of the Spirit that raised Christ from the dead is the same power that brings somebody to faith. Whenever someone exercises faith in Christ, repents of their sin, trusts in Christ, that is a repeat of the resurrection miracle when Jesus came from the grave. I don't know if you realize that or not. That's what it is. And in some ways, it's bigger Because when Jesus raised from the dead, that was just a bodily resurrection. When someone comes to faith, their sinful condition of deadness and decay is changed. And a light comes on, and they realize now who they are without Christ, and they embrace it. That happens because of God's power. And then when Christ comes back and our bodies are raised and resurrected and glorified, that's God's power. So those two things happen because God brings about two miracles. And now here's this is where we start shuffling in our seats. That same power changes when we're converted, and will one day changes when Christ comes back. This is Paul's question. Or Paul's point. How is it changing you now? If it's not changing you now, don't talk about how it changed you in the past or how you think it's going to change you in the future. That's Paul's point. Remember, when I was growing up, maybe I'll do it here, I don't know. I remember when I was growing up, my home church, we had testimony services where people would just stand up and talk about how the Lord's working in their life, maybe prayer requests and how we're thankful for things the Lord's done. And that was the whole service. Preacher had the night off. And a lot of times, I was just a kid, but as I got older, and a lot of times I would see people saying, I want to thank the Lord because on February 2nd, 19, the Lord saved me. And that's wonderful. But then that was about it. Not a whole lot of what's he doing now. What sins are you overcoming now that you were wrestling with 5 years ago that you're doing? What areas of the Lord, is the Lord changing you now? What areas are you more Christ-like now? What are some areas that the Lord's showing you that you can change now? We won't talk about how that was changed back then, how we got punched our ticket to heaven. And we want to talk about how Jesus comes back and gives words like Christ, we don't have glasses or worry about cancer anymore. But we don't want to talk about how he's saving us from sin now. He's saving you from hell. But what about gossip? What about lust? What about prestige? What about pride? Laziness? What about all that? Gossip? Hatefulness? What about all those things? He didn't lead us to faith and empower us to have faith in Christ just so he could raise us from the dead one day. We've been saved so that we can become like the Savior who's going to change. And Paul says, I haven't reached it yet. And we're not going to reach it. But what do we do? Chase it. Why? Because we know we're going to finish the finish line. I mean, you're never going to see me, well, I know you never said it, but you're never going to see me, as far as I know, jump out of the plane and do skydiving. It's not going to happen. Because whatever contingency that could happen to one parachute out of 1,000, it's going to be mine. If the Lord Jesus came down the cloud and said, this is a parachute I made for you, I want you to jump. I would still think about it. I'd probably have a church boat on it. And then, yeah, I guess probably I would. Probably would. But only because he made the parachute. And so I'm putting my trust, I'm in the parachute, from the one who made it. I'm not putting my confidence in a company to make it, no. Lord made it, okay, we'll go. I'm still not going to be happy about it, but I'll do it if I know that I'm going to finish well. And that's Paul's point. We know we're going to finish well, so jump. Strive. But what's the struggle? Yeah, of course it's a struggle. Yes, it's a struggle. But here's the thing. The struggle allows you to see God work in your life. That's the thing. When you struggle and wrestle, the Lord will work. And use that working to change other people too. So whatever changed us in the past, it's going to change in the future. Make sure that we allow it to change us. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for its power. Thank you for the Spirit of God, I know that indwells us. And so we have the resources we need to strive after. Lord, pray that you would help us each day. Just take those steps. Lord, sometimes, yes, we can take big steps. Lord, if we just take little steps following you, Lord, we'll be satisfied with whatever grace you pour into our lives through. use us for your kingdom and to reach others. Thank you, Lord, for your love for us, knowing that we're weak and frail on our own. We pray, Lord, that you would help us, each one here, let us lead each heart alike with you, Jesus. As we go for announcements again after service, just remember, elders and myself are available to talk with anybody who wants to have questions about the Lord or some special prayer requests. I'm more than happy to talk with anybody after. Let's
pray. Thank you, Dr. Everett. If you chose to join us today and you're a visitor, we're glad that you chose to worship with us today. There's a card in the front of the seat in front of you. We'd love to know that you're here by filling that out. Members of it as well, we'd love to know that you're here. We do give an alternate meeting to pass in the plate. We have a vendor handing out water today. We have an executive sleep like a baseball game. We go all out. One of the announcements does have to do with the plate. I think it's the 25th, the youth is going to have a lock-in, and so they need a lot of adult help, and you need to get with Alan and Austin for the permission slip. Also, you need to turn your plate back in so they'll have something to eat off of. The truth. Considering what they usually eat off of the lock-ins anyway. But please get with Alan, because Alan wants a lot of help, because I know he wants to stay from 9 to 7. And Dr. Nathan, well, if I make him stay the whole night. So please get with them about the permission slip. If we can have the ushers come front, we'll take up the collection. Dear God, thank you for this day. Thank you again for the opportunity to worship you. Thank you for the message that you sent through Dr. Everett. Thank you for this praise band and this dedication to you to sing your praise. Be with us as we give back a portion of your richly blessed us. In Jesus' name we pray.
And then don't stand as you worship, and I'll do the offering.